Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Diane. Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Okay, so happy day when we're good morning. Happy day when we're able to be joyous and all that stuff. But poor Craig Coyle. Nobody ever loves him. Isn't he the most unloved guy? Oh, no, he's the most loved guy. I forgot. So he's been working on an instrumental prelude for us, and so let us just get silent for a second, and then listen to Craig play on the organ, and then we'll get proceeding even further into the service.
Thank you.
My gosh, was that long. Oh, my Lord. I was falling asleep. I said, where's the coffee? I got to get some caffeine in here. You know one reason why that's so long? I'm taking a wild guess. Because he's not going to crank up the beast for a while. That's what we call when we bring in the concerts on Sunday nights and the Pride concert that we did. We refer to it as the beast and always start up with the 2,000 pipes, three manuals, i.e. keyboards. The fourth is the feet where a lot of the growling bass is. But we're going to be getting to this a little bit later, but this is the last Sunday for the choir during the season, and then we'll be moving shortly into the reception room where there's no organ. And last Sunday is for the Sunday school, so we'll be talking about that in a little bit. But first of all, I see the Bradleys are here, Joe and Jan Bradley. Just wave. Come on, Jan, wave. There you go. Don't be shy. They have, for how many years have you been working on a food pantry? 15? 15 years handing out groceries at the food pantry Thursday morning. Imagine in 15 years the health crises, the family changes, the weather, on and on and on. 15 years. So they're here in worship. Thank you very much, you guys. And then in comes Herb Harrop this morning. Can you hear us, Herb? Herb Harrop is back. I called Rich Miller over, chair of the trustees, and when I saw Herb, I said, hey, look, Herb's back. I said, how are you doing? He says, oh, I'm just not feeling good. I said, look, let me cut to the chase. It's busy. I got to go to my office and get the service going. You're 89 years old, and you're going to outlive God. So it's amazing what this guy has gone through and been through and still comes back and comes back and comes back. So welcome back after a long illness. It's good to see you back. It's good to see everybody, including the people who I can't literally see but are on Facebook seeing us or YouTube. So welcome to you guys as well. Couple quick announcements, and we'll get right into the fun of the service. One is... The bulletin says stuff, and it's inaccurate. So we're going to be moved, just because things had to get changed. So we're going to be moving the recognition and stuff up a little bit after the prayer so that the Sunday school can go out and have some fun. So we'll be moving that up shortly, and Will knows about that for the sake of the screen. You may have noticed, if you didn't, you can just turn around and look. There's the condors in the reception room hanging from the ceiling. Those were put in last night. That's part of the art exhibit that's going to be here next Sunday. For many years, at least probably a good 10 years, we've been having, used to be annual, once a year, art exhibit by an organization called Projecting Arts, which is Latino artists. The last one was eight different countries, artists from eight different countries. We're all represented here. They had the Ecuadorian embassy had sent in people to attend this art exhibit in our church. So this year, we were on sabbatical from that because of COVID, but this year they're back, and it's really interesting. It's next Saturday at 7 o'clock. If you don't want to attend, don't. But it might be fun. It's always fun. It's always the dancers, the music that they do, the art. It's really a blast. But next Saturday, they're doing the theme of the national bird of Central and South America, which is technically condor. And there's three species of condor. I know too much about this already, so I'll stop there. But they're going to have more art exhibit coming in. And they're going to have Peruvian dancers that have these costumes and these dances that have been in Central and South America for centuries. And they're going to be doing traditional dances from Ecuador and Peru and other countries in the area. Also, young persons who were here last night rehearsing, they do it in costume, dressed as condors. It's really incredible. Can you tell I'm excited about that? That's Saturday. Then, fin- 7 o'clock. We'll be putting out an email blast on it as well, probably tomorrow or Tuesday. But 7 o'clock next Saturday. There's a nominal donation at the door. If that's an issue, let me know and pay it, and I'll pay you back. We'll make because we if you want to be in, you're in. Or just pay it if you can afford it, because it that barely touches their expenses. Next Sunday, another reason why Craig wanted to kick out the dust from the organ here is that he is going to be on his, in his contract it says he's, how many weeks of vacation did you get? 3 weeks of vacation, and between the two of us, in the last 3 years, we've had like 1 week each. So he said, I'm going on vacation. I gave him a demotion. I yelled at him. I said, wait a minute. You set a precedent. You haven't had a week off in 3 years. Why are you starting to act out now? But he's going to Ireland. Yep. With his family. And we're going to have Jimmy Nagel back, who played guitar for us in the reception. He fills in lots of times when Craig... You've never even heard him play, right? Have you ever met him? Met him once. Okay. So Jimmy's back, and we have Joy in the Morning is the subject next Sunday, and Jimmy Nagel is a pianist and a vocalist, but he's going to be playing Three Little Birds, coincidentally, by Bob Marley on ukulele. And then, Kathleen, what are you singing next week? Happy Days Are Here Again, accompanied by Craig Noyle. Craig Noyle. Listen to that. Jimmy Nagel on piano, and then the choir, not the choir because we don't have a choir starting next week. We're all going to sing Joyful, Joyful. So the whole point of the service is let's keep what's going on here and try to get some good times in. The more dire the news gets, the more I say, yeah, right. This is just a little slice in history, and some of it is depressing and some of it is joyous. Like today. Oh, yeah, one more. After this service is a reception. We've ordered sandwiches for you. There's a big cake in recognition of the Sunday school and the choir and everybody. So what a blessing that is. So I would ask, since it's such a blessing, maybe the choir can help us out with Bless the Lord, O My Soul, which is based on Psalm 103.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, I've got sort of like two age groups I'm going to talk to, one after the other. One is your age. Many of the confirmands, not all of them are here today, but there were nine of y'all, right? And sometimes a lot, and it's a common cliche, and I hate it. I hate very few things. I hate getting hit in the nose, and I hate another thing that says that confirmation is graduation. Because that means you get confirmed, you get your ticket, and you're out. And that happens over and over again, church after church after church, year after year after year, decade after decade. But, we need your help. And that doesn't mean that you have to be here next. I want to plant a seed with you. And you might have noticed, this world is in trouble. And there's certain areas where I hope we have taught you guys, and you have learned here, especially under the leadership of Anne and Chrissy, that you're not powerless, that you're loved, that you're equal in the eyes of God to any young person, any older person, any rich person, any poor person, any member of the church, non-member of the church. You are spiritually equal to them, period. And I hope to God, and to be honest with you, especially young girls, young women, and more so than boys in a way, because of the way society is structured, that you can hold your own. And even if you're being yelled at, put down, younger ones in particular, any bullying going on, that you could say, hey, I am a child of God, as equally blessed as any teacher in my school, as anybody who's deciding whether or not I get into a college. If anybody is saying you can have a job or not, you might not get into college or you might. You might not get the job or you might. But God loves you. I know that. I believe it in every soul of my body. Every cell of my body. And if I've ever taught you anything, I hope that that message comes true. And I want you to think about, like, ecology or renewal of the earth or protecting of the waters. Or what you can do for recycling. There's something that the church can do. Remember when we went around, I said, if this was your church, what would you do at the Sunday school? What would you do in the pews? Anna Banana said, well, I would put erasers on the pencils that you put on the prayer cards in case you change. It was your idea? Then why did you tell me it was your idea? Oh, never mind. Never mind. You guys can fight it out in the back. Okay. And then, if you were in charge here, would you have a sermon or not? What would you, what about, well, we would use the gym more often if you were in charge of the Sunday school. Took you down to the soup kitchen. You're not powerless to change this world. We need your help. I'm getting old and tired and weak, just like Steve. And, yeah, it's all right. You can't hit me. I can run. I can run. Besides, if you can't take a beating, don't be a pastor. Okay? We need your help. So come back and say, hey, you know what? We've been thinking about this, and a group of us would like to use a room in here because we want to meet and talk about this or do this or help with the soup kitchen or the food pantry or get something going with ecology or use the gym, any of that stuff. And we will, I will, and I know a lot of these people, we will be supportive of you to the best of our ability. Hi, you made it over here. Now I'm done with you guys. Younger persons. It looked like we were going to go from nine confirmation kids to no Sunday school. Get over here. Get over here. See? She listens to me, Dad. Okay. It looks like God is good. It looks like we're going to have a Sunday school. Next year, after all, we'll be talking to the trustees about this and stuff, right? But we've got at least five kids and two-year-olds that are going to be here. And then we've got five or six kids between five and eight or six and eight. We had some meetings about this. We've been looking for a Sunday school director, maybe a one-room schoolhouse. And so we're on it. Heather's on it. Diane Larkin's on it. Several of the people here are. So we're doing our best to be
to serve you. You know, like, we're going to, like, you, your mom or dad or caregiver or loved one might serve you lunch or serve you dinner. We're looking for you. We want to serve you. We want to serve you and say we want to serve your soul. So we're going to have a Sunday school. Over the summer, it gets a little weird because we don't have the Sunday schools out and the choir's gone, but we're starting back. And we're going to have you guys all together. And you're already making friends, right? Look this way. There we go. Say, hello. Okay. I think I'm done with you guys right now. But then you need to stick around for the prayer, then we're going to do the recognition, okay?
The morning prayer is printed in this morning's bulletin, and we'll pray it aloud and together. And also, it should be on your screen if you are joining us. It is on your screen if you're joining us via Facebook or YouTube. Let us pray aloud and together. God, the Creator, God of us all, you are the ground of our being, the beginning, middle, and end, the Alpha and Omega of all creation. God, the Comforter, God with us, you have shown us the saving depths of divine love and the full potential of human life. God, the Sustainer, you enable us to become the people we are meant to be, like wind beneath our wings, like shelter over our heads. You are around and within us. May our service glorify you. Amen. So now, a little bit of the rewrite of the service, because the kids and others want to skedaddle into the back and have a lot more fun than the adults are going to be having up here. And so, raise your hand if you're a father and you have not received the medallion gift that I received also. Are there any fathers who have not received this? No? Okay. Is there anybody who has now or has ever had a father that did not receive one of these? Okay. Will, did you get one of these? Okay. Do you have one, Heather? Take one of those back to Will, who is working our soundboard. Okay, back all the way back there. Will with the earphones on. Straight back. Run as fast as you can. You can't catch me. The gingerbread man right back there. They don't teach you this in seminary, by the way. This is called the moment in ordained clergy when you say, "Dear Lord, I have lost control." All right. No, joyful noise unto the Lord, right? There we go. She, you know what? If she runs around and Madison's going to run around with her, as long as she doesn't go face planted into a pew, that's fine with me. Okay, very good. Okay. Oy vey. I run as fast as you can. Hey, it's fine with me. It really is. You know why? Because I don't have to chase them. Chaser. Okay, now, the Sunday school co-directors, have you already received your flowers? You received your bouquets? You want to hold them up then so the congregation can see what they provided for you? Isn't that beautiful? Beautiful. And then if the Sunday school co-directors would come up, we have an additional little gift here from St. Amazon Prime. St. Amazon Prime sent these to you. Rich Miller, they'll be on the trustees' bill. Okay. Yeah, stand up just for a second. They hate this part. How long have you been Sunday school co-directors here? 5 years. And you were one of them also, Lisa. It was the trifecta, I called them. And then she had the audacity to go get pregnant and then have what we call the hope child, because he was baptized on the first Advent Sunday. And so we, Tammy Torelli was their predecessor, and we said, okay, we can take Tammy Torelli's salary, divide it in three, and give it to each of the three of you. And they all declined. For 5 years, we have had free service of what could have been a paid position. And so I really hope that, and they came here because of a wedding, right? Who was the what was the first wedding here? Your and Chrissy's wedding, right? Steve and Chrissy got married here. And then a second wedding, and then a baptism, and then another baptism. And then all of a sudden the grandparents start showing up, and we have Joan Blair and others. And so we had these two families, and if you guys leave, it's going to be really sad. It really is. It really is. I mean, some of the stories of some of you guys, and I heard Steve giving a children's sermon sitting on a chair years ago in the gym, and he was talking about how one bad decision can change your life. And in his case, it was not wearing a seatbelt. And I walked by the gym, and I thought, oh, my God, the honesty. And he was just sitting there. He didn't know I was watching or walking by. It was so beautiful. Just every single decision you make, and you can extrapolate from not wearing a seatbelt to all other one single decisions that you can make that can mess you up. And it was so honest and so beautiful. So I really hope you guys stick around, and you deserve your little honorarium and your flowers and stuff, and especially if you have to put up with the likes of, you know, Steve and your husband. Okay, sit down. Okay, we've got one more to go, and that's Craig. Do you have a microphone, Craig? And so who would you like to recognize? Do you have them there, Will? Okay.
So the choir, who we all love so very much. So they're here every Thursday. And no matter what I throw at them, it can be traditional choir music, it can be pop music, it can be worship music, it can be drumming, it can be whatever I throw at them. They are always just willing to do whatever I ask them to do, and they're really easy about it, too. Nobody gives me any trouble over anything. They're like, yeah, we'll do that, sure. And they always pull through in such a great way, and I'm just so happy to have all of them here, and we should all be really thankful to have them as part of our service every week during the year. So we don't pay them anything. They are all volunteers, and we're all very, really thankful for you. Thank you so much for being here. So we have a few gifts for them. And I'm just going to introduce each one of them. And, thank you very much. We have Rochelle, who is – you don't have to stand up or do anything. I'm just going to introduce you. Rochelle, who's our soprano. Right?
Raise your hand.
Yeah, raise your hand. Rochelle Schmidt is our soprano. And Kathleen Dubitosi, who will be soprano or alto whatever day it is. Kathy Youngquist, who is our alto. We have tenors, Titus Khanna and Brian Gutman. And our basses, Stephen Martin and Rick Disney. So thank you very much, choir.
Did you say Kathleen?
Yeah. So thank you very much, choir. We really, really appreciate you, and we're so, so glad and thankful that you're able to enhance our worship experience here. Thank you.
Two bouquets each? I guess they're schizophrenic. Give one for each personality, maybe. Okay, now, it being Father's Day, I would like to invite two fathers to come up and speak about whatever they're going to speak about. I have no idea. I didn't ask to look at it. It's going to be as much a joy and a surprise to me as it is to you. So the first father that we call forth to give us a little chat is Titus Kenna.
Good morning, everybody, and happy Father's Day. This is a condensed story of my father's life. Many of you knew my father, Milan, better known as Mill. He was stationed at Camp Upton during World War II and walked into the USO here in Patro with a camera around his neck. My grandfather, Herb Austin, also an avid photographer, volunteered there. I can picture them, no pun intended, being drawn to each other with their shared interests. 2 weeks later, he met my mom. My father became a dad in 1949 with brother Tim. He and my mom lived up in Vermont when Tim was an infant until mom got polio. They sang in the choir together at the Congregational Church in Newfane, Vermont. My father stayed there to close the house that they rented while mom was being treated back on Long Island. They bought their Belport house in 1952, the same year that Todd was born, and assumed their roles here at the church. My mother as administrative assistant to Reverend Stuart Vancott and director of the junior and chair of choirs, and my father sang in the bass section. I was born in October of 1954 and baptized here in January of 1955. He, my father, like me, was a baritone. There were many good tenors back in those days, so he sang in the bass section. I remember that he would often break into falsetto at home, showing me that he could sing tenor if he wanted. I was in both the cherub and junior choirs and literally did look up to my father. I remember fondly when we sang, "Oh Holy Night," with combined choirs under the direction of Tom Cator. The chancel was packed with kids, and the senior choir was about 40 strong. It was not only packed in the church on Christmas Eve, but with the choir loft and chancel being much smaller before the renovation and expansion, we just about exploded at the seams. Having grown up in Yonkers with his twin brother, Al, he wasn't as athletic as my brothers and I, but he always encouraged us. He loved to hit baseballs out in the yard. Sorry, I choke up occasionally reading this. It can be hard. He loved to hit baseballs out in the yard to test our outfield skills. He also played a mean horseshoe game. He taught us woodworking skills and how to fix things, including my bike. I'm forever grateful for that. We never had great tools, but got by with what we had. He made our dreams come true by buying a 19-foot sloop. Skippering was done by Tim, who learned from our next-door neighbor, then Todd, then finally me. Dad loved to go sailing with us, but always wound up in the wrong place when we came about. We were lucky we didn't capsize. Sailors would understand that. Were there any favorite Father's Day memories? My parents weren't big on Mother's and Father's Day celebrations, but being that Father's Day fell during the height of strawberry season, and his favorite food in the world was cheesecake, that was more than enough to make it a special occasion. He was known to stop at diners during lunch break went out on the road as a salesman for Monarch Marking System Company and have only cheesecake for lunch. His sales experience definitely carried over into his social life. He was friendly and could talk to anyone. His retirement job as head concessionaire at the Gateway Theater was the perfect way to meet new people. He and my mom loved to entertain at home, and at the end of the evening, he was always on dish duty. He didn't cook. His greatest culinary achievement was cooking ramen noodles years later after mom passed away. You were not allowed to load the dishwasher, and if you did, he would reload it. There was a proper way of doing it. No sense in teaching the kids how to do it. He would always happily do his duty without complaint. His passion for photography remained. I used to help him in a makeshift darkroom in the kitchen where we temporarily set up an enlarger with chemicals under a safe light. The kitchen couldn't be darkened, so printing could only be done at night. When my mom would return from her job at the Gateway Theater, Dad would ask her to turn the car headlights off so as to not fog the photographic paper. When Belvoir High School offered a photography course for the first time, Dad loaned me his twin lens Rolleiflex. His teaching and influence definitely rubbed off on me. Even though I might have wasted 2 years as a geology major, he was thrilled when I transferred to Rochester Institute of Technology with a photography major. I wound up in New York City as a fashion photographer, and he came in often to watch my daughter when I traveled. Now I was the one teaching him many things about photography. He was a well-loved grandfather to 7 kids and became a great grandfather before he passed away in 2013. I feel his presence whenever I'm in this church. I looked up to him then, and I still look up to him now. Happy Father's Day, Dad.
Whew. The second father that we're going to call forth to talk about Father's Day, whatever he's going to address, himself as father, his father, both, I don't know, Dennis Sinnott.
Happy Father's Day. Titus, that was really beautiful. It's going to be tough to follow that up. So when Dwight first asked me if I'd write a tribute to my father, I was like, that's going to be easy. And then later it dawned on me the hard part is going to be not making it sound like it's a tribute because my dad would think I'm practicing for his eulogy. So there's a lot I could say about my dad. You know, I just want to, more than anything, just kind of articulate who he is and really how he shaped me to be the person that I am today. My dad is somebody who instilled good values in me throughout my life. While I certainly do not agree with everything he says or does, he has shown me that is okay too, to disagree. He'd never used words like acceptance or tolerance. I learned that by watching him. He never said be inclusive or who I should be friends with. His circle of friends always included people of all races, backgrounds, educated, non-educated, rich or poor. My dad did not get a college degree, but he's a great teacher. My dad lost his parents at an early age, and he worked 2 jobs, both of them full-time, and still made it through high school because he needed to help support his siblings. He ended up marrying the woman that he started dating at the age of 16, and they remain married to this day. Despite my mom's residence for the past 15 years being a nursing home, my dad visits her every single day and spends about 2 hours. know, he is, so he's demonstrated to me, you know, what love really is. It's not a word, it's an action. There's much I could also write that frustrates me about my dad. He's a stubborn Irishman. I guess maybe I am a little bit too. The positives far outweigh any negative. If I had to mention just one area, I'd like to pay tribute to, despite having limited means, he was the best memory maker I could ever think of. In fact, even my cousin calls my dad the memory maker. The memories were really born from going camping, spending time at the beach, being introduced to skiing, and just having a good time, you know, and about experiencing things and spending time with others. I always reflect really fondly on those memories as a child, and I always wished I could have imparted the same on my children. And I've done my best that I could at that, but my dad set the bar pretty high when it came to creating memories. So in closing on this Father's Day, I just wanted to say that I think that my dad is a great tribute to what fatherhood means. I love him very much, and I look forward to being able to spend today with him. And God bless all the dads out there.
Well, we're going to hear the choir in a moment as they come forth. They're not being honored today or recognized because they're still working through the summer. But we've got the deacons who are working so hard to set this up. We've got Tex Dennerline, who's sitting on the couch over here. We've got Erin Kelly, wherever she is. She's back there working. We've got Diane Larkin, who's in the hallway working. Diane, can you hear me there? Tex, go get we really need to do this. It'll take just a second. Have Erin Kelly and Diane come in. We have Joan Blair, who has stepped off of the deacons, but she's still here whenever she can be of support. And God forgive me and have mercy on my soul if I forgot anybody. I think we're pretty square there. So we have Erin Kelly and Tex. And, Jen, who also, for health reasons, Jen Weaver has stepped out. So Erin Kelly and Diane, what we're doing, y'all, is just, we're saying that you deserve recognition, although you're not technically a part of it, because you're still working. So isn't that weird? We don't recognize the people who keep working. So thank you guys very much. And thank you, Joan, for your service to the deacons and your willingness to step in whenever. So what these people have done is proven that they not only are shining the light, or they have headlights, or they have lights in their house, but they actually are a light. They are beacons of light that come forth and show the goodness of the church that they do selflessly without pay, just loving on y'all so that we can have cake and sandwiches and flowers and little gifts for fathers and sharp pencils in the pews and the handing out gifts, handing out the bulletins, on and on and on, the duties of the deacon. So thank you all also. And don't you think they're shining their light? Not only shine a light, but be a light. Let's hear now, be a light from our choir.
Yeah.
Let's hear it for our unpaid choir. Okay, I'm loving on y'all. I want to just say Paul Baker, we have him joining us today. We did, he and his husband waited over 30 years for the right to be married, and they were married in this church several years ago now. So welcome to you, Paul. We have Lorraine Goetz, who's here after having a lot of health issues. She's back a couple weeks in a row, and her husband has health issues behind her. And if I leave anybody out, forgive me, Beth Marvin. She hates to be singled out, but she deserves it. Her husband passed, Ken, and we had the service. The choir sang there. We did a beautiful service for her husband as well. So there's a lot of joy. There's a lot of light. And it's also in the context of sometimes in life there's a lot of pain and a lot of sadness. In the middle of hate, be the light. And that's what we try to do here. We are the Apostle Paul said, we look like fools to the world. We are fools because we look like fools. We're fools for Christ because we show up at a place like this, doing things like this while other people are eating donuts. What are we? We are fools. And he said, but also to us, sometimes the people who say, yeah, the world is hate. Yeah, it is. Nobody cares and all that. That we look like fools to them because if we could just, or as Jack LaCitra, Jack Waterfall at the PryCons, he said to me, Dwight, I play music all over the place. And wherever I go, it's like if people realize what they're looking for can be found here, but they won't have anything to do with it. I don't know what to do. He's you know, half my age, and he was just chuckling like, oh, well. He said, we know what to do. He called his band Jack's Waterfall because he said, we just keep pouring the water. It goes over the falls. It splashes on the rocks. We don't know where it's going, but we just keep doing it. And that's what we do here. Here comes, God bless me, a short sermon. I want to do excerpts of the Carolyn Savasano has some very serious issues coming up, very, very serious health issues. Her husband Tom is here. We could go on and on. You're all honored. We're all honored. Here we go. Excerpts from Psalm 116. God is gracious. It is God who makes things right. Our most compassionate God. God takes the side of the helpless. When I was at the end of my rope, God saved me. What can I give back to God for the blessings God has poured out to me? I'll lift the cup of salvation, a toast to God. I'll pray in the name of God. I'll complete what I promised God I'd do. And I'll do it together with God's people. Thus ends the reading of excerpts of Psalm 116. Somebody who I studied, I've read his poems here, unbelievable poems. You may have heard the name or you may know the work of the legendary African-American pastor, teacher, and writer, Howard Thurman. He wrote an autobiography because he was famous in his own lifetime and is much even more famous now. And he could have dedicated his autobiography to any number of famous people who he had pastored, including when they were still students, Barbara Jordan, the writer Alice Walker, and Martin Luther King Jr. He could have dedicated his autobiography to his beloved grandmother, who played such an incredible part in his life. But instead of dedicating his autobiography to these or many other worthy people, his biography, titled With Head and Heart, is dedicated to an unknown stranger. To quote Dr. Thurman, in his book, to the stranger, this is the dedication in his book, to the stranger in the railroad station in Daytona Beach who restored my broken dream 65 years ago. Young Howard Thurman was sitting in a railroad station, and he didn't have the money to cover the transport costs of his trunk. He had his ticket, and he had a little trunk of clothes, and he didn't know that they charged extra for this. So he's sitting there trying to make his journey to go away, because he had to go away, because there was no such thing as a high school in the community where he was. So Dr. Thurman writes in his autobiography, "I sat down on the steps of that railway station and I cried my heart out. Presently, I opened my eyes and I saw before me, looking down, a large pair of work boots. My eyes crawled upward." It's okay, it's a little kid freaking out in Sunday school. Thank God we don't have to deal with it, but an unpaid somebody is doing back there. So he sees these work boots as he's crying his eyes out. How am I? I can't leave my clothes in my trunk here. I've got a ticket for me. I don't have a ticket for that. What am I going to do? So he's crying. He sees these work boots in his eye. My eyes cried. Dr. Thurman writes, "My eyes crawled upward until I saw the man's face. He was a black man, as was Howard Thurman. He was a black man, dressed in overalls and a denim cap. As he looked down at me, he rolled a cigarette and lit it. And then he said, 'Boy, what in the hell are you crying about?' And I told him," quoting from the book, "'If you're trying to get out of this,'" this is what the man in the denim cap says, "'if you're trying to get out of this damn town to get an education, the least I can do is help you. Come with me,' he said. So he took me around to the agent and asked, 'How much does it take to send this boy's trunk to Jacksonville?' Then he took out his rawhide money bag and counted the money out. When the agent handed him the receipt, he handed it to me. Then, without a word, he turned and disappeared down the railroad track. I never saw him again. That was to whom he dedicated it. Somebody, an unknown guy who sees a kid crying. 'What the hell are you crying about?' As he's rolling his own cigarette. 'I don't have the money to get my clothes to high school. Come with me.' Carrying his money in a rawhide bag, counts it out, and then walks away down the track. Did that guy have any money? But he was generous. God is everywhere. God is everywhere. If you want to find God, you don't have to look to this. You can, because I believe there's evidence of God in this book. If you want to find God, look for love. Wherever you find love, I'll guarantee you, by whatever way you define God is up to you. Look for love and you'll find God. If you want to find love, look for God. You want to find God, look for love. You want to find love, look for God. And God might appear to you like a kid with upside-down sunglasses in a stroller who's going to be the next piano player because he lights up at the music. I see God. The Advent child of hope. He'll never forever be known by me. When I want to find God, and I want to feel God, and I get out of my car thinking, how am I going to do this again? What do I have to say? And I walk in here, I see God in this congregation. I see God in you guys. I promised it would be a short sermon, and there it is. So, let us now have the ushers come forward to receive the free will offering to the church. Your financial gifts are gratefully received and, dare I say, much needed. If you're unable to contribute at this time for whatever reason, your presence alone, and we mean this, is a great gift. If you're online, at Facebook or YouTube, if you go to the Please Do Church. You know what I always think whenever I hear these people pass the basket? Say, put a penny in. Because you can't tell God, I want to take, but I don't want to give. Because I don't have enough to give. Can you imagine God saying, I'd like to help you out, kid, but I don't have enough to give. I'm tapped. So it's a river, like a river. A river has an inlet and an outlet. If a river has an inlet and the water comes in and it doesn't go out, it becomes a stagnant pool. There are no exceptions to that. An inlet and an outlet. So if you can give a little something, if you're online, go to the website, Church on Main Street, all spelled out, S-T-R-E-E-T, churchonmainstreet.org. In the upper right-hand corner of the opening page, it says donate. There's a red donate button that'll take you to PayPal. If you don't have the wherewithal to do that, then send in a check or whatever you want to do. And if not, once again, you're blessed, you're welcome, you're part of this congregation. Okay, the offering has been received, and now I invite us to pray aloud and together for those who care to join. A prayer that has become known as the Lord's Prayer. We ask people to pray it whatever words they may be most familiar. We pause and wait for y'all to catch up because debts is shorter than debtors, and which is even shorter than trespassers, and sins is shorter. You just say whatever you want to say. Or just sit in silence if you so choose, but let us pray aloud and together the prayer that our faith tradition tells us and has told us for over 2,000 years, that Jesus originally taught to the original disciples, and we are not the original disciples, but we are the disciples of a living, loving God, present and scattered and gathered. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we come to a halt of this service, in this building at least, and we adjourn for chasing children. We'll just wait till she gets a piece of cake. We're really going to have to pull her off the walls at that point. Go back and look at the condors that are on the ceiling waiting for you next Saturday. In the meantime, we've got a choir loaded on the chancel. You can turn to hymn number 17. We're going to sing verses 1 and 3 only of Great is Thy Faithfulness, 1 and 3 only. Stand if you wish or remain seated if you wish. may be seated to receive the benediction. Listen to the postlude and then skedaddle out of the town into the sandwiches and the cake, wherever. Until we meet again, either in the reception room or next Saturday for the condor, the bird of the Andes, or next Sunday for Jimmy Nagel, and wishing our prayers of safe travels to Craig Coyle as he goes on to Ireland. Let all of us not only be the light, but be a blessing. We receive blessings. How dare we? How dare we withhold the blessings we have received from other people? Blessings flow through us, not to us. Through us. Be a blessing. May the light of God shine down upon you. May the light of God shine out from within you and bless not only you, but the lives of all those who you meet and touch. You may be the gospel that some stranger walking down a track with a hand-rolled cigarette in his mouth may be looking for. Pass it forward. In the name of God, amen.